Hi, I'm Ali Patterson. On this episode of Fintech Finance, we're taking a look at IT security and how this fits into GDPR. For this, we catch up with I.T. Governance in Cambridge, Ulster Bank in Ireland, Finance Inspektionen, and mBank over in Poland. Firstly, I went to speak with Professor Alan Calder from I.T. Governance to talk about data protection by design for clients.
So it's, in a sense, a mark of where the big shift is for organisations in complying with GDPR and their data protection directive. What you'd hope to do is be able to point at a number of minor things that you've done around your activities, tick box kind of activity that can show you've been sort of compliant with the Data Protection Act. What GDPR says specifically is that organizations have to implement data protection by design and by default, which means it has to be designed into your processes. It has to be at the heart of the culture, the governance framework, the risk management frameworks, the behaviors of the organization as a whole. So when it talks about what are called the six data processing principles, the core principles about how personal data should be looked after, it adds a seventh, which it calls accountability. It says the organization has to be able to demonstrate in applying the six data protection, data processing principles, that it's understood that it's accountable for complying with the regulation and for looking after data protection. So the levels of fines that I was talking about earlier will be based very substantially on the extent to which organizations ignore their accountability. So data protection by design and by default leads organizations to look at GDPR compliance as a journey rather than as a destination, as a shift from something where you can say, well, we think we've done enough, to a part of an organizational strategy which sees that over a 3 to 5 year period, you have to go from treating data protection as an add-on to something which is fundamental to how the organization works, such that not only do breaches happen infrequently, but if they do, you're able to demonstrate that you've taken appropriate steps to protect personal data throughout your processing.
So a lot of banks are obviously quite intimidated with the regulation. They always come through in the end. But what would you tell them if you were trying to ease their fears or advise them in some way in how to accept GDPR or PSD2 in the future?
At the end of the day, the modern technology has to empower the consumer to be better able to use the services, to get financial services out to more people in more types of population that has perhaps not received those services. It has to enable consumers to get financial services at cheaper cost, of better quality, and perhaps to increase the accessibility and ease of use. So I think it boils down to those very simple questions. So at the end of the day, I think it is a question about offering better products to consumers and doing it at a lower price and making those products more appealing to customers. At the same time, well-functioning financial markets are a public good. That's why we exist as supervisors, to make sure that the markets can develop freely and new ideas can flow at the same time as financial stability is ensured and consumers are well protected. So we have the mandate to make sure that we protect market from those excesses which cannot be taken care of private sector actors themselves. When financial innovation occurs, and this is irrespective of the questions whether supervisors should do something in particular to support innovation, I think we have to come back to our key role and understand that when a new financial innovation occurs, we as supervisors need to A, understand it, and B, figure out if that innovation creates externalities which might be detrimental to consumers or which may be detrimental to financial stability. And in case those externalities exist, we need to ask ourselves if we need to regulate something. And if we conclude that we might need to regulate something, then we need to figure out whether costs of regulation exceed the benefits from regulation. If the costs exceed the benefits from regulation, then probably we should do nothing. If the benefits from regulation exceed the costs, then there is a good case for us to do something to protect consumers and financial stability. It's a very simple kind of intellectual framework, but it's important to keep in mind, where is our role in all of that?
I was interested in how companies can convey risk when it comes to cybersecurity.
So the challenge for organisations is that GDPR says that they have to, taking account of the risks to, quote, the rights and freedoms of natural persons, they have to select and apply appropriate technical and organisational controls. GDPR doesn't really give you any clues as to what appropriate controls might look like or tell you what risks you have to consider. It just says if you get it wrong, you're going to get into trouble. So organizations have to think very hard about what personal data they've got and how they're protecting it. And of course, cybersecurity at its heart is about protecting data, while cybersecurity strategies are typically built around protecting all of an organization's data, and usually both digital and analog data, because they're just different forms of the same stuff. What GDPR is saying is focus all of that activity on personal data. Most cyber breaches involve the theft of personal records, they involve corruption of personal records, and so that's one of the reasons why the UK government, as part of its own cybersecurity strategy, has identified enforcing GDPR compliance as an effective method of forcing organisations to address cybersecurity more effectively. So organisations have to think not just about anti-malware software, but about designing into their processes where they're collecting personal data appropriate mechanisms for protecting that against what the regulation calls a data breach and defines as any accidental or deliberate undermining or corruption of the confidentiality, integrity, or availability of that data. In other words, it's not being available to be used or not able to be used for the purposes for which it's collected. And it's those breaches which you have to report to the Information Commissioner, and it's those breaches which, when you report them, are likely to lead to investigation and are likely to lead, therefore, to fines. So the convergence between data protection and cybersecurity comes at the heart of organizations thinking about what their data protection strategy really has to look like.
So this is the first API where a bank is using the customer's account details and information. Can you tell us a bit more about the security behind that and how you're eventually going to roll it out?
Sure. I mean, well, firstly to say that we will only ever share customer data in the advent of PSD2 and open banking after a customer has given us the express consent to do that. I think that's really important. We are not in the business of sharing customer data without them asking us to do that. We have initiated and set up a very rigorous onboarding process to determine which third parties we actually want to do business with. So in the same way as you'd expect us to do that onboarding for new clients and customers, we'll be applying that regulatory oversight, that compliance, that checks, all of the things that you would expect a bank to do before it gets into business with a third party. We will be doing all of those checks, and we will be setting ourselves and organizing ourselves as a company to enable that. So that's the first thing. We won't be doing business with people that we don't trust or don't have the right, traditions or respect in the industry. The second thing is the technology itself. To enable the sharing of this data with the power of RBS and leveraging the best security authentication models in the industry, we've applied and are applying all of those to the sharing of the data. So we're really confident that we've done that. And then we would, because we take ultimately our customer security and their data protection really seriously. And of course, with things like GDPR and data privacy and open banking, there are tensions and complexities within those regulations that we have to manage. But at the heart of it, what we want to achieve is a secure transfer of customers' data with industry standard securities. And that's exactly what we've applied with this API.
What is mBank doing with all this data, and how is it keeping it secure so the customers know that all their private information will be secure in the future?
Technical resources are well known. Not to mention, we as a bank are super highly regulated and supervised. And on top of that, we understand it's actually our core business to be very secure, not only with the customer money, but also with the customer data. If it's one place when your personal data are still quite secure in today's world, it's in bank.
And can you give me an example of where you've used this data to help the customer experience?
We are using this for the customer experience, but also we are using that for our efficiency. let's take customer experience. Something I mentioned already, real-time marketing. It's not only for our purpose. Yes, we would like to build a valuable relations with the customers with the next sold product. But if we, for instance, see the customers looking for something in the digital channels and somehow is unable to finish his task, then we exactly know what's happening and we are addressing it. Yeah? We are able within actually seconds to call the customers if we see that he's, let's say, having some troubles on our mobile app or in desktop banking.
I was interested about how companies deal with data protection, especially with new regulations such as GDPR coming into force next year.
The temptation for banks, if we take PSD2, certainly historically has been to focus on being compliant. The big winners from PSD2 are customers. If we just focus on being compliant, I think we miss the major strategic opportunities that certainly exist. There are challenges and complexities, but the opportunities, in my view, are much greater. So our job actually here is, yes, to be compliant, but in doing so, working out actually how do we want to use PSD2 and open banking to provide new services and products and platforms to our customers. And we in Ulster Bank are delighted to be able to say that we have launched and have developed an Ulster Bank API. It's Ireland's first open API in response to this change in banking, in response to open banking. And it effectively provides a mechanism for fintechs and third parties to develop products and new applications to provide services to our customers. And it does that by enabling a secure, seamless access from a third party to our customers' data. And in this case, the data in question is account balance and the last six transactions, for example. But to be really clear, we would never share customers' data with anybody without the customer's express consent to do so. But what we have built here is a capability to turn PSD2 and open banking from a hypothetical, in some ways, theoretical concept into something that is real, and that we will now start to develop relationships with third parties to determine if they're the third parties with the right credentials and trustworthiness that we want to access our API portal. And if they are, and if our customers give their express consent to share their information with those third parties, we can now create the mechanism to do that. And that's a first in Ireland in banking, and we're very proud and we're very excited by the various opportunities and services and products that that will open up for ourselves and for our customers.
One of the things that banks are having to deal with is obviously the increase in regulation at the moment, especially when it comes to GDPR and PSD2. Can you tell us more about what mBank's doing in that sphere?
Okay, so starting with GDPR. I would say that we are analyzing this topic for many months. We are not the first to embrace these challenges, especially from the customer perspective. And I would start from the customer's perspective. This means what is your general approach to customer data? And you think about what is the general approach worldwide in many sectors, I would say there are two camps. One camp is Apple camp. They are, let's say, eager to say, we don't distribute your data to anybody. We are not using this for, let's say, advertising or our products or any other. And there is the second camp, Google, which offers everything for free in theory, but let's say use this data not only to prepare a very personalized products, but also advertise and make money. We have to use every opportunity to be very effective. We also would like to deliver this excellent experience to customers like Google, which means using data for personalization, for being, let's say, very intelligent with dialogue with the customers. So currently, I would say most of the banks are closer to, let's say, being like Google, which means a huge challenge in terms of implementing GDPR. But nevertheless, what we are going to do is, be very transparent with our customers. Before, the May 2018 will come, we will communicate exactly why We are asking the customers to give this permission to make the personalization. What are the benefits? And actually, currently, it's not decided, but I think we are more inclined on the position that if you really would like to experience what we have, what we want to offer to you, you should give us consent. Otherwise, we have to, let's say, think about some alternative channels, alternative options. How can you use our services?
How can IT governance really help organizations when it does come to looking at their data and their data protection?
IT governance is the one-stop shop for organizations tackling governance, risk management, and compliance. And given that you need to tackle your GDPR compliance, it's much bigger than simply a legal program. It's about compliance with the law, it's about cybersecurity, it's about continuity, it's about incident management, and it's about translating a set of documented requirements into processes, procedures, staff awareness, and knowledge. Organizations need to draw on the support of suppliers who can package all of those kinds of components together. And that's what, as a company, we specialize in. We specialize in linking together practitioner training with what our consultants can do in terms of support, with staff awareness training, with a range of books and tools and document templates, and all of the things that in different mixes, different organizations need in order to get GDPR compliant. So typically we help a client. Some of our clients simply want a little bit of help. They'll want some books and some tools. Others will want access to a mix of those, plus practitioner training, plus perhaps staff awareness training, which we deliver online. And yet others will want some mix of those with consultancy support, either fairly off the shelf or very tailored for their own requirements. And as I said, we'll package those together in ways that enable us to help clients get started on their journey to ultimate looking good against the requirements of GDPR. And we can support that with additional services like data protection as a service, data protection officers, ongoing GDPR audits. So we help clients with whatever it is they need to get compliant.
On the next episode of Fintech Finance, we're taking a closer look at cybersecurity.